leaders might just say, well, everybody back home, and we would have missed a real important opportunity.
That's a question or a statement?
No, the question is simply, are you going to keep up your approach that the Arabs won't talk to you, and if so, why?
It's not an approach, it's a fact. But the other fact, as I said, that the only reason we're here at 11 o'clock is because of the spectacle that the Arab delegations performed at 10 o'clock. I fully agree with you, and this is our desire, to have the contacts done informally. Now, Madrid's been over, some of you, many of you have been to Madrid. Madrid's been over, what, 2.5, almost 3 weeks ago. In those 3 weeks, Israel has made several attempts to make contact with the various Arab delegations, various Arab parties, I should say, and none were successful. But again, the crucial question is whether the Arabs are truly interested. I must say, I can't help resisting the fact that since you represent a movement for Arab democracy, I don't know if I should...
In London.
I don't know if I should congratulate President Assad for receiving 99.992 of the vote in his recent re-election in Syria. But when you talk about popular Arab opinion, I would very much like to have this newscast, as we had this press conference, as I had a previous press conference in Madrid, broadcast to the Arab world. We don't fear this kind of direct contact with Arab opinion. We would like to have popular Arab opinion expressed, because I believe that when the Arab peoples are presented with the facts, not with the distortion of the propaganda, but with the facts of the Arab-Israeli dispute and our own efforts here, that they will in fact look much more kindly and more gently, shall I say, on Israel and on the prospects for peace with Israel.
Oath.
I'm Ruth Simon with the AP. Do you feel that the point you were trying to make, in other words, that the Americans can't just snap their fingers and you'll show up, has been made? What is it the Americans have told you to reassure you, as Ambassador Shoval said, that they will no longer be acting as a mailman? And do you feel that they might have perhaps misestimated or underestimated the extent to which they could push you to the wall?
I'm not going to get into interpretations of American assessments. I will say that we were yesterday told in very clear and reassuring terms by American officials that the United States does not seek to replace the negotiating process, that it wants to have the Arabs deal directly with Israel. In fact, I was told by one official that the Arabs had made 15 points that they wanted to raise with Israel, and they took it to the United States, and this American official said, no, take it to Israel directly. That's exactly the right approach. And I think that in addition to the questions of substance, the form of the negotiation, the fact that the Arabs have to talk to us, and of course we to them, is as substantive a part of reconciliation as the actual subjects of discussion.
We'll move to the other side of the room, please.
Keenan Block with me. Keenan Block with me, Neil Lair. If the sides are still arguing, divide about something as basic as whether or not this round of talks begins today or begins Monday, how are you ever going to reach agreement on the truly daunting big issues that face all the sides?
I don't think that's what we're arguing about, frankly. I don't think the issue is Wednesday or Monday. I think the issue is process. That is there a negotiation that takes place between Arabs and Israelis, or is there an Arab idea that somehow the United States will impose conditions on Israel? That's an erroneous idea, both from Israel's point of view and the American point of view. So the issue really here is not dates. You're quite right. The question of dates from our point of view is tertiary, quaternary, it's trivial. What is not trivial is the idea of a direct channel between us and the Arabs, where there is give and take, a negotiation between us and not something imposed from above. That is not trivial, and that is not secondary.
But I hope you hold out for success on these big issues.
The sooner,
where you are now,
the sooner we establish this principle, proved so successful in Camp David, the sooner we establish the principle that there is an Arab-Israeli dialogue and exchange as opposed to something else, the sooner I think we will have success, perhaps even rapid success. What is important, though, is to establish it at the outset. And I think it cannot be established any sooner than today.
Let me add, perhaps, I think all these questions about delay are now really watered under the bridge. We have made our point, and there isn't a single person in this room who doesn't understand. We have made our point loud and clear. And with that, it's finished. The whole question of timetables and venues would have been avoided if the Arab sides had talked to us directly. What chance is there for peace if the Arabs will understand that they need peace, just as Israel needs peace, and that the only way to achieve it, especially for the Palestinians, is only with us, talking with us, and not to somebody else. There's a good chance we are coming here, I want to say this to the lady from Jordan, with very substantive proposals, especially with regard to the Jordanian-Palestinian question, but also to others, if they take us up seriously. I believe progress will be made. We have all the intentions because we want to find a solution to that problem. It's not just their problem, it's our problem.
Okay, Norm and then Connie.
Norman Kempster of the Los Angeles Times. I think the ambassador just answered my first question, but just to be sure, I'll place it again. Are you prepared, if the talks begin on Monday or whenever they begin, are you prepared to discuss substance?
Yes.
And if so,
yes.
How long do you expect this round to last? How long are you prepared to remain in Washington to talk substance?
Well, I personally will remain in Washington for quite some time, but this is just going to be the start of the second round of conversations, of negotiations. We hope they will move as soon as possible near the region or to the region. I can't specify whether it will be 1 day or 2 days or 3 days or something like that. It will not go on for a long time here. And as Deputy Minister Netanyahu has indicated before, if we could have settled some of these technical questions, even now, even before Monday, then we could really devote all the time from Monday and on just for substantive issues. And that's our intention.
Connie, please.
Connie Lowen, Israeli Radio, English News. Mr. Ambassador, do you, in all this time, in all the discussions with the Prime Minister and so forth, have any points of substance yet been touched upon? And also, do you have any guarantee, any assurance that the Syrians and the other delegations will remain here and talk on Tuesday?
We have no guarantee or assurance. As a matter of fact, we have no guarantee whether the Syrians are very, very interested in the peace process. Some of their statements have indicated the contrary. As a matter of fact, we understand that the Syrian broadcasting system never told its own people that we have actually sat across the table next to each other or facing each other in Madrid. But if they are interested and if it's made clear to them that they should have an interest, hopefully they will remain. We have no assurance of that.
Okay, the gentleman over there.
I'm over here with Haaretz, Israel Daily. Mr. Netanyahu, for decades, consecutive Israeli governments have said that they will meet and talk to the Arabs wherever they want, whenever they want. And yet, at this very moment, three Arab negotiating teams are sitting and waiting for the Israelis to show up and talk to them directly. And that, yet the Israelis have not come. Can you explain in a simple, comprehensible way why the Israelis are not there?
Number one, we are coming to Washington. We weren't consulted in a way with the Arab delegations. We didn't reach an agreement with them on place, but it's very easy to do so. I think our view right now, frankly, is this. We can pick up the thread of peace in Washington, but we have to weave it back into the Middle East to a real tapestry of peace. To do that, we need to have the Arabs talking to us directly. We've had no such discussion. The Arabs can say, we are coming on Wednesday. But they didn't talk to us about coming on Wednesday. They can say, we're not going to be there on Monday, but they're not offering a different date. What they want is merely a series of fiats directed against Israel. That's not the negotiation that we have said we wanted all those years. We want a real exchange, and the best thing they can do right now is pick up the phone.
Okay, we'll take three last questions, please.
Joe Albright from the Cox newspapers. I wonder whether you could spell out for us as in much detail as you can, giving names and dates if possible, all the Israeli efforts since Madrid to contact the Arabs, which you say that they have not responded to.
One effort has been described by Ambassador Shoval here in Washington. There were other attempts, not in the United States, but I'm not going to get into them.
Well, how many and where? Why
there were several. There were several. We don't necessarily...
Why are you not able to talk about that?
Because part of the value of these contacts is the fact that they're, in fact, not exposed, as the journalist, the Arab journalist from London said correctly. There are certain channels that you want to keep not public for the simple reason that they're useful away from the cameras. And with all due respect to you, ladies and gentlemen of the press, there are some contacts that are best kept away from the glare of publicity.
Tom?
Habibi, can I ask you, since everyone's talking about substance, can you, the Israeli press this morning is full of reports about precisely what Eli Rubenstein will be bringing to Washington on the question of self-rule and autonomy for the Palestinians. Can you give us some general, at least, descriptions of what is your substantive opening bargaining position on the question of self-rule, particularly with reference to the thorny questions of water, land, and source of authority? And secondly, can you give us a sense of what is the opening Israeli bargaining position on the Golan Heights? The American letter to you suggested that Israel test the Syrians, offer, if we are ready to withdraw from all of the Golan, what kind of peace are you ready to offer us? Is Israel ready to go that far?
Yes, I will respond to you as best as I can, Tom, but I don't want to begin the negotiation here, as you can understand. Sometimes journalists have a difficulty understanding that, but I think that
I understand. Everyone's talking about substance, so let's talk about substance.
Well, I think that there are two responses to your question. The first, concerning the territories, Judea, Samaria, Gaza. I think we have a vision in mind of an interim settlement that does the following, that gives maximum security to Israel alongside minimum interference with the running of the daily lives of the Arab population. I think that this is the watchword to look at. Security for Israel, maximum security for Israel, minimum intervention in the daily lives of the Arabs. There are many issues that have to be resolved. The general framework of Camp David, envisioned in Camp David, basically said that in this interim settlement, which is what we're discussing now, as you know, so the question of final borders is not on the agenda at the moment, by agreed upon consent. When you're talking about an interim settlement of limited self-administration, we're talking about the symbols and prerequisites of sovereignty, of sovereign rule remaining in Israeli hands. That means, first, military security, security against terror, the question of foreign policy, the question of the control of the borders, the question of currency. I've just given you the key ingredients of sovereign power. Those remained with Israel by agreement in Camp David. The question of self-administration, all the questions of self-administration, and the precise meeting, the precise juncture between questions relating to the first level and questions relating to the second level have to be worked out in negotiation. The questions of security, for example, are obvious in that regard. What is the span of security? What is the span of the other authorities that each of the two sides will have? That is something that has to be negotiated. But the concept in general is the prerequisites of sovereign power remain with Israel for the interim period. The Palestinian Arab population can move from a position right now of this intifada that Ambassador Shoval talked about to a different arrangement altogether, where they can begin to have much greater control over their daily lives, and I hope to create a different climate between Israelis and Arabs pending the final settlement. Now, the question of the Golan, I think that in many ways we would like to hear, before I even respond to that question, an agreement on the part of the Syrians to the basic ground rules laid by Presidents Bush and Gorbachev in their statements in Madrid. They said very clearly, they said, we are talking about not just non-belligerency, but peace treaties. The Syrians refuse to accept that to this very moment. And obviously, unless we see some kind of change there, it's going to be very difficult to move on with the substantive proposals, which we will raise in the delegation talk.
But are you saying that, just to clarify, that before you present any substantive proposal for dealing with the Golan, you are insisting as a precondition that Syria commit itself to the final objective of a peace treaty?
No, I'm saying that the proposals that we are going to present, we will present in the context of the delegation, not in this room. But I am saying that we would like, and I think, excuse me, I think the